गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
कैन यू हियर मी? घोष, कैन यू हियर मी?
सर।
अनुषा, कैन यू हियर मी?
गुड आफ्टरनून।
आई कांट हियर यू, सो लक्ष्मी, कैन यू हियर मी?
यस सर।
अनुषा,
यस सर। गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
Can you hear me, Anusha? I'm not able to hear you. Check. Hello.
Sir.
Hello, can you hear me? Anusha.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
I'm able to hear you. Gauss Pasha, can you speak, please?
Sir.
I'm not able to hear you. I'm not able to hear you, Ghaz. Able to hear you, Anusha. Yeah. Hello. Can you hear
Sir.
Me now? Yeah, I can hear you now.
Sir.
Please speak a bit. Goes.
Sir.
Speak a little, say hello. Hello, hello, say twice. Say hello. I can't hear you.
Sir.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
Huh. Okay. Now I can hear you. All right. So let's get going. We are already a little delayed thanks to this glitch. Zoom is not the friendliest. None of these are very friendly, actually, to tell you the truth. Yesterday I was talking to you about how most of the Mahajanapadas that have been described by right-wing historians are those which have come from mythology. Mainly the Mahabharata, and to a certain extent, you will also find that there are a few kingdoms mentioned from the Ramayana. For example, Matsya and Kosala, both are from the Ramayana. And Matsya also figures in the Mahabharata. Okay, and I was trying to tell you that Kashi or Varanasi was shown as a Mahajanapada, but it was more of a pilgrimage center, a self-regulating pilgrimage center. because of the belief of the Hindus from ancient times. I told you it is the longest and the oldest city with the longest occupancy, meaning people have been staying in that city for thousands of years. Okay, they have been staying there for thousands of years, and therefore this city is considered to be the oldest in the world. And there is absolutely no doubt about that bit anyway. The right-wing historians claim that Varanasi or Kashi was taken over by Kosala, which is not something that has been proven. But when we look at this Mahajanapada thing, I did tell you that there are three entities which could possibly be called Mahajanapadas. They are Malla, Vajji, and Asmaka. Okay, and people, I told you, say that in Asmaka specifically, there was a ruler, a chieftain, who was assisted in governance by a samiti. Okay, so this is something that we have carried over into post-independent India, panchayat samiti. Okay, we talk about panchayat samitis. When NTR came, he changed the system from the panchayat samiti to that of the mandal system. The mandala system also existed in ancient India, but the samiti system was there in the Asmaka territory. Malla and Vajji were, I told you, considered to be oligarchies. They are oligarchies because they have been ruled by a group of people who all shared the power and took collective decisions. But they perhaps do qualify to be called Mahajanapadas. And among all these writings, there is no mention of the Mauryan Empire. The only empire, that they mention and as a Janapada is the Magadhan Empire or Magadha. And the North Indians call it Magadh. There is also a Magadh University in Bihar. The Magadha Empire was, it started off with Rajagriha as its capital. And as it started expanding and occupying more and more territories, Pataliputra became the capital of this. And Magadha became a proper empire, not just a kingdom, an empire, because it conquered huge territories for its time. It conquered very big territories and it swallowed all the Janapadas that were there. And if there were any Mahajanapadas, those also got swallowed by the Magadhan Empire. So when we look at the Magadhan Empire, what we actually find is that there is a combination of mythology and history. Okay, there is both a combination of mythology and history. And you find that the only real history which has been established so far talks about Bimbisara. This is where we had come yesterday. I was talking to you about Bimbisara. And Bimbisara was somebody who ascended the throne of the Magadhan Empire at the age of 15. And I told you he belonged to the Haryanka. Okay, Haryanka, Haryanka dynasty. And the present day Haryana is named after the Haryanka dynasty. Okay, when Punjab, at the time of partition of India, Punjab got partitioned into West Punjab and East Punjab. What we got is the East Punjab, though it is to our west. Okay, later on, the people who spoke this language called Haryanvi, which is derived out of the language that was used in Bimbisara's times, they said we are different from the Punjabis, and therefore there was a creation of a separate state because the linguistic basis was linguism or linguistic or rather the language, I'm sorry. The language was supposed to be the basis of the creation of a state. So the Haryanvi said, we don't speak Punjabi, we speak Haryanvi. Okay, and so they asked for a separate state, which they got, and it came to be called Haryana. While we are at this, I would like you to know little bit of general information. If you write your competitive exams tomorrow, you will need this. You know, we say that most spoken language in India is Hindi. Okay, that's what people will tell you. That's what every book will tell you. But the fact of the matter is that a number of different languages, some of which are dialects, get merged with this language called Hindi. Okay, dialect, D-I-A-L-E-C-T, dialect does not have a script. The difference between a language, a proper language, and a dialect is that dialects usually do not have a script for writing, whereas languages have a script for writing. Now, if you look at Hindi as such, when people say these are all Hindi speaking people, they are not Hindi speaking people, all of them. In Bihar, okay, since Magadha Empire was in Bihar, there was this language which I told you was like Haryanvi, okay? And they later on seem to have migrated to the other side. Then today what we have there are languages like Bhojpuri, B-H-O-J-P-U-R-I. Bhojpuri is one language that is used. Another language that is used there is no mention of this Janapada, which was called Mithila, M-I-T-H-I-L-A. And Mithila, some people claim, is where Sita came from. And so she was also called Maithili. That is what people say. So Mithila people present day Bihar, okay, they speak a language which is called Maithili. Okay, they speak this language Maithili. In Uttar Pradesh, you have a different form of Bhojpuri, And along with that, you also have another language called the Braj Bhasha. The Braj Bhasha apparently was the language used by Lord Krishna. Krishna is supposed to have used the Braj Bhasha. And that is what we are told is Hindi. It is not. If you hear somebody speak Braj Bhasha, you will not understand it. Sorry. Neither will you understand Bhojpuri. Maithili is impossible to understand. At least Bhojpuri, you can make out some words here and there. And just as an interesting aside, I had so many Bihari friends in my MA days in Delhi, in the hostel, that I learned how to speak Bhojpuri. At one time, I could speak it quite fluently, but over a period of time, since I haven't had anyone to speak that language with, my skills with Bhojpuri have become very rusty. Some of the Biharis used to speak Maithili. I couldn't learn that language. It is so, so difficult to learn that it was impossible to learn it. So you have these languages, and then you have Haryanvi, and you have various other dialects. India, you must understand, has more than 700 dialects. Okay, all of which, or most of which, get clubbed with this language called Hindi. Okay, they are actually not Hindi. They are different languages. What we see as what people call Shuddha Hindi, which was once the language used on Doordarshan, is a Grandhik language. Grandhik meaning it is the Hindi that is used to write Grandhas, or the not the spoken language but a written language. When you write a Grandha or you write a book, you use a different kind of a language, and the Hindi that people say is Hindi is actually 90% Sanskrit. Okay, 90% of it is Sanskrit. Similarly, if you take Telugu, Telugu people say is a classical language. It was there before Sanskrit. But if you look at Telugu today, most of Telugu has become Sanskrit. It's become Sanskritized. Words from English have got into it. Words from Urdu have got into it. Okay, and incidentally, when people say Hindi, they also put Urdu in that bracket, where they also Urdu speakers are added there, and all the tribal people of Chhattisgarh then Jharkhand, they have their own tribal languages, but they are also counted as speakers of Hindi. Even Kashmiris are counted as speakers of Hindi, which is not really the case because Kashmiri is a different language. So I just wanted to give you that because this will be useful for you if you're taking any competitive exams like the UPSC or whatever. Anyway, so Magadha, the first known ruler is Bimbisara. The Jains also flourished along with the Magadhan Empire. And the Jains basically call him by two names. One, which is Senia. Bimbisara was also called Senia. And he was another name given to him by the Jains was Shrenika. Shrenika, actually, you have to write an S, put a dot on the dot, so it is not Sh, it is Sh. Okay, Shrenika. That was the name given by the Jains to Bimbisara, who is definitely a historical figure and not a mythological figure. And Bimbisara is very interesting for another reason, because Bimbisara took his name after a Mauryan emperor. Okay, the first big Mauryan emperor was Chandragupta Maurya. We are aware of that. In fact, he's the founder of the Mauryan dynasty. Okay, and his son, whose name was supposed to be Simhasena. Okay. Chandragupta Maurya's son's name was supposed to be Simhasena, but he took the name Bindusara. 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 Okay. So he was the he was the son of Chandragupta Maurya, and he was the father of Ashoka, the really big emperor who basically talked about Buddhism and this Sanchi Stupa, all those. His father is Bindusara. He was actually called Anitrocrates, 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 by the Greeks. Okay, because people say Bindusara was the son of the wife that Chandragupta Maurya took, who was a Greek lady, the daughter of Seleucus. I told you that story. I hope you remember it. If you don't remember it, go back to YouTube and check on it. You will find it. Okay, Seleucus gave his daughter in marriage. So his this thing is Amitrocrates. So that is one of his names. But he, for some reason, took the name Bindusara. I have been trying to find out what these words mean. Bindu, from what I have got from Sanskrit, is a droplet of water or a drop of water or a liquid. That is a bindu. So Sara is that which is representative of that droplet. So funny name, Bindusara. Bimbisara, I have searched, I could not get what is its meaning. Okay, why did he name himself Bimbisara? But Bimbisara also was the father. So this shows that the Mauryan Empire came before the Magadhan Empire. Okay, this came before the Magadhan Empire. And I'm very surprised as to why the right-wing historians have left the Mauryan Empire from their description of the Mahajanapadas and the other things. Okay. Because this is not something based in any Mahabharata or Ramayana. It was an actual thing there. Okay. But for some reason, they have left that out of their list. Magadha, they reluctantly added to it. And I've been trying to understand what Bimbisara means. I'm not able to get the meaning of Bimbisara. So now the importance of Bimbisara is that he was also the father of one of the most successful Magadhan kings whose name was Ajatashatru. Okay, Ajatashatru. Ajatashatru. Yeah, Ajatashatru. Ajatashatru was a very successful emperor, and you see that it is the growth of the Magadhan Empire happened very much under the leadership of Ajatashatru. And Ajatashatru is also referred to sometimes as Jivaka. Okay, he's also referred to as he had a brother called Jivaka. Ajatashatru was the elder son, and the younger son was Jivaka. And Bimbisara, Ajatashatru, and Jivaka are the definite historical figures that one can take from the Magadhan Empire. Now, if you look at all the other names that I have gone through, Matsya, Kosala, Chedi, then Malla, Vajja, Asmaka, Anga. If you look at all of these, their mention is not as either Janapadas, nor are they mentioned as Janapadas or Mahajanapadas. They are not mentioned as either of that. They are simply mentioned as kingdoms. And the rulers of these, even if you say that the Mahabharata was real, if you say the Ramayana was real, the rulers have been kings. They have been rajas. Okay, so even if you take the mythological aspect of things, these people are rajas, which means that you have the transition from a Janapada, sometimes maybe through a Mahajanapada, but definitely to rajyas. Because please understand one thing, even if we are taking the Mahabharata and the Ramayana as pure epics, and they are not to be taken as histories, even if we take this argument, you will find that the usage of the term Rajya and the usage of the term Raja is indicative of the fact that there were Rajyas. So the dating system, it may show clashes, but if you put that aside for some time, that there is a clash in the dating systems, what we do see is that there is definitely Rajyas. You know, that is the reason why people are calling them Rajyas. It's called Matsya Rajya, it's called Anga Rajya, okay, it is called Chedi Rajya, Kosala Rajya. It's called Rajas, right? So this indicates that there was a reality called Rajas, which is different from the Janapadas, the Ganapadas, and the Mahajanapadas. Okay, like I told you, the Ganapada is probably to be used only in the context of Shiva. Okay, but if you do look at Janapadas, they existed, and Mahajanapadas is a gray area, and Rajas is definitely not a gray area. It is there in black and white, because all these have been called Rajas. Okay, if there were no Rajas, there would be no word to describe them as Rajas. So let me give you a very simple example from an anthropologist, a very famous anthropologist, pathbreaking anthropologist called Peter Winch. Okay, P-E-T-E-R, Peter, W-I-N-C-H, Winch. Now, Peter Winch, for various reasons, which I don't want to go into right now, he wanted to show that rationality is not linear as we make it out to be. Rationality is not progressive as we make it out to be. In order to demonstrate that, he studied a number of African tribal practices. Okay, he studied a number of African tribes and their social practices and political practices as well. So those are probably quite close to the Janapadas that we had in our own past. Okay, and in one of the tribes that he studied, and the language, he was very keen on studying not just the political and social organization of those tribes. He also studied their languages. What kind of words did they use? What did they signify with what words? And so in doing so, he came across one language. You will have to forgive me, due to non-usage of this information for a long period of time, I have forgotten the name of the language. I thought it was Gikuyu, but it is not Gikuyu. It is some other language. So please forgive me for not being able to give you the actual name of the language. In one of the languages, he found that there is no word which is the equivalent, even roughly, the equivalent of rebellion or revolution. Okay, he said he looked through the language very, very carefully, but did not find any word which signified or showed or meant the English rebellion or revolution. And then he studied the society, and he found that in that society, there was complete obedience to authority. There was no questioning of authority. Okay, so if the authority, whoever it is, the tribal chieftain or the medicine man, as they call them there, if they said you have to do something, then people did exactly that. They never questioned and asked, why should we do this? What will happen if we don't do this? They didn't ask all those. So they just obediently followed orders. Okay, orders that were given to them, they obediently followed them. And as a result, he studied the history of that tribe. Never was there a revolt or a revolution. There was no rebellion. And that particular tribal society was one of complete harmony. And since nobody ever raised a question against authority, nobody contended against authority, it so happened that that particular language did not contain a word which would convey either the meaning revolution or rebellion. Okay? Just remember one thing. Why do we use the word good? We use the word good because there is bad. Right? If there was no bad, if there was only good, then there would be nothing to describe that as. Do you get the point I'm trying to make? You know, the point is, because there is bad, there is also talk of good. But if there was no bad at all, there would not be a word called good. Right? So similarly, if there isn't a certain kind of a social practice, a social reality, then there would be no word to describe that. The fact that Rajya as a word figures in the epics again and again and again, and it figures in various other texts also, the Rajyas, it shows that there were Rajyas. They definitely were Rajyas, and Rajyas were monarchical. Unlike in the Janapadas, where it was one person assisted by a samiti, or Mahajanapadas, where it was oligarchies, okay, groups of people ruling. Unlike that, there's no one source of power. Monarchy, an arch, I told you, is representative of power. Monarchy basically means mono, is single, one source of power. And that means the Rajyas were kingdoms. They were monarchical. Bindusara, Chandragupta Maurya, then Ashoka, okay, and later on Bimbisara, Ajatashatru, Jivaka, all these people were monarchs. Okay, they were kings, monarchs, not just kings, they were monarchs. They chose people to advise them, but they could say no to them if they didn't want to follow their advice. Okay, and Ashoka clearly shows that he had become a conqueror. The Mauryan Empire came all the way to Odisha, right? The Kalinga War, which is what Kalinga was the old name for Odisha. Okay, and that comes almost into the northern coastal districts of